The fact is, the British establishment is feeling left out and ignored by the Indian establishment, especially in the technology and defense sector. And one heard from different interlocutors there that Britain is very keen to have a similar program like the ISET that India has now initiated with the US, the Initiative on Critical and Emerging Technologies.
Yeah.
Now, the question is to identify, or the main task is to identify those technologies which are useful for India and also has some spin-off or at least some benefit for the British industry or the British government and the armed forces. That is where the challenge is, and this is just a beginning.
Hello and welcome to The Gist on Stratnewsglobal. Good evening, I'm Surya Gangadharan, and welcome to another edition of our primetime evening show. My guest this evening is our editor-in-chief, Nitin Gokhale. And as many of you may be aware or may not be aware, he was in London towards the last week of July to attend a workshop, a defense workshop, jointly organized by the International Institute of Strategic Studies in London and by our sister website, bharatshakti.com. And the workshop looked at the military technological cooperation between India and the UK, looking at it both in terms of hardware, in terms of other high-tech areas, and let's see where the two countries can collaborate. So this is something that was discussed. Nitin, let's go to you for details. First of all, this is just off the top of my head.
Sure.
I mean, our two countries have known each other for decades,
sure.
Centuries.
Yes.
But the defense cooperation has taken time to really...
In fact, it has just deteriorated or just gone off the radar off late in the past 10, 15 years. Because if I take you back to the 60s, the first two aircraft carriers that Indian Navy operated were British origin.
Yeah.
They were leased or... given away by the British Navy, the INS Vikrant, which played a stellar role in 1971 war with Pakistan, and then later INS Virat, both of British origin, British Navy had got this. So, and then of course we had the Jaguars, which had come from Britain, and the Hawk trainer jets for the Indian Air Force are still in service.
Yeah,
they were bought from Britain. So in that sense, it used to be a very deep and important strategic and defense partnership, or at least relationship. We used to import everything from Britain that time. But somehow in the last 15 years, I would say, things have gone south. And others like the United States, Israel, Russia, of course, was always there as India's partner, defense partner. And France have overtaken UK as India's preferred defense partner.
So that was what? This was the Cold War politics? It was...
There were a couple of things that over the years, Britain also didn't have much to offer for what India was looking for, except for these hardware that I spoke about, which came from Britain that time. And second was its attitude or its insistence to hyphenate India and Pakistan.
Okay.
The British old policy of... I won't call it divide and rule, but also keeping the balance in the subcontinent and its interest in the subcontinent, which kept Britain from coming closer to India or giving India what it deserved at that point in time. So India also gradually moved away because it had other options. And this is now being realized in 10 Downing Street in London. And therefore, this workshop that... While there is a possible synergy, we haven't really utilized the opportunities to come together and work on some common programs, joint programs. That hasn't happened.
So given how the British military footprint has shrunk, you know, I think the British armed forces must have got a couple of brigades or something.
No, well, yeah, there are about 100,000 overall. But they retain some of the old legacies and I would say edge in some of the technological innovations that they used to do earlier. And they're also good at, their intelligence is excellent. They're good at information warfare. They have a separate information brigade, in fact, the British military, which was raised way back in 2012, when the world was still waking up to influence operations, information brigade, or information warfare. All that was not happening. The British actually re-raised old brigade which was there in the Indian subcontinent called the Chindits Brigade, the 77th Brigade, and made it into an information brigade for the British military to direct and control narratives about Britain and the British military. So there you are. They still have some of that edge in which they continue to punch above their weight in international politics.
So when you look at it in purely physical terms, I'm talking of military hardware, you know, what do they have?
Well, they have the Rolls Royce engine, which is, I mean, used the world over in various civil aviation and military jets, which they have. They have a good industry in advanced materials. They have some good innovative projects. They also, as I said, they also have something on propulsion. For ships, for aircraft carriers especially, and they are now graduating into electric propulsions, which will take some time to come, that technology. But that was one of the proposals or one of the ideas that was floated, that where they can help India or the Indian Navy was on in generating or in taking forward the proposal for electric propulsion.
So is this, these are kind of stuff they already developed? Or in the process?
They are in the process, but one project which everybody knows, it's a public knowledge. Rolls-Royce had been working with DRDO, with GTRE in fact, to be more specific, in trying to develop a jet engine for India's Tejas light combat aircraft. It has been a long-standing project. They work together very closely, but somehow it didn't meet the requirement. They couldn't go beyond the 80 kilonewton thrust. As far as that engine power was concerned. And India, Indian Air Force and the HAL and the Aeronautical Development Agency finally junked that, not junked that project, but didn't take that engine for the LCA Tejas. Instead went for the G404 engine for LCA Tejas. But there are, one learnt during the workshop when we were interacting with different people, that there are many takeaways from that project where they worked there so long. And both DRDO and the British company, as well as the British government sector, I would say labs or whatever that they have, equivalent of DRDO, can work or build upon the lessons learned during that project was something that was talked about. And that is where they're looking at. But as I said, the futuristic project that they're looking at is the electric propulsion for Indian Navy.
So the Indian Navy is actively looking at
electric propulsion going forward. I mean, it's like I said, it is not yet a fully developed technology, but somewhere it has to start, that kind of cooperation. And, you know, if it happens to be a cooperation that you start off at the early stage of its development, then it's a spin-off for both countries. And that's where they're looking at it. They're very, very keen to offer it. And of course, Rolls-Royce still hasn't given up hopes to become part of the advanced medium combat aircraft project, which the Indian Air Force has in its plans in the next decade, where it is competing with GE as well as with Safran, as we know, from France. But Rolls-Royce being Rolls-Royce, they're trying their best to sort of offer the best possible deal for the Indian Air Force.
I understand the Brits also have some project, some pan-European project involving a fighter aircraft.
Well, they were not exactly in that project. The Eurofighter was one of the earlier projects that they had done. And they would not mind if something of that kind comes through. But after having done Brexit and after having come out of the European project, I doubt whether they'll have anything to do with, you know, those projects there really. But what they're looking at actively is cooperation or joint ventures and joint development in or joint technology to be developed in fields of advanced material, maybe stealth UAVs, UCAVs or UAVs that they're looking at. They're good at some of those, and they don't mind offering that for co-development. Mm-hmm. The basic fact here is more geopolitical than geo-economics or concerning defense.
Mm-hmm.
The fact is, the British establishment is feeling left out and ignored by the Indian establishment, especially in the technology and defense sector. And one heard from different interlocutors there that Britain is very keen to have a similar program like the ISAT that India has now initiated with the US, the Initiative on Critical and Emerging Technologies.
Yeah.
Now, the question is to identify, or the main task is to identify those technologies which are useful for India and also has some spin-off or at least some benefit for the British industry or the British government and the armed forces. That is where the challenge is, and this was just a beginning. And this was proposed by IISS, the Institute, International Institute of Strategic Studies, as you mentioned. They came to us in Bharatshakti, and we were happy to be part of it because we also took some Indian technocrats earlier working with the government, just out of the government. And they had some of their serving people coming in there. The Indian High Commissioner Vikram Doraiswamy was partly there during the day. We had the chairman of the National Security Advisory Board, Ambassador P.S. Raghavan, speaking there. The deputy NSA of the UK government spoke. The permanent secretary of defense of the UK government also delivered an address. So basically, it was a very frank discussion. And the Indians, especially those who have worked with the government in India, also very frankly articulated India's concerns over British stand on not discouraging the separatist Khalistani elements, for instance. Also, constantly attacking India on the perceived human rights violations in India, democracy blacksliding and all that. So those were very frank discussions that happened, but which are supposed to be not in public domain. That's why I can't give you anything more than that.
So let's look at ongoing programs here, like the NCA,
sure,
submarines and so on.
Yeah.
You think there is a British a possibility of helping us to kind of leapfrog some of the technological issues here?
Maybe in submarines they haven't explored it, but there are many companies which are now, of course, pan Europe. There is MBDA, there is, yeah, Thales. I mean, not Thales really, but MBDA. Then there is the Rolls Royce, of course, works there. The GE, non-engine part of the GE company is also in UK.
Mm-hmm.
They were interested in giving something to India. Like I said, there were other technological advances that they've done in quantum, in AI, which they can offer, but not so much in the military hardware as such at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
But they're looking at emerging and futuristic technologies to have a joint venture somewhere with India or Indian entities going forward. So DRDO remains a crucial player as far as the partnership, possible partnership with the UK establishment as well as private companies are concerned.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned they have an intelligence brigade. So is there...
Information brigade.
Information brigade.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I presume it does the intelligence work.
I suppose so. I think there's a clear distinction between the MI5 and 6 on one hand, and they still have footprints all over the world. They are still, they and their cousins in the US continue to be influential or at least well-informed int agencies. But the Information Brigade is in the Defense Ministry, in the Ministry of Defense,
okay,
which has developed techniques, which has developed a database on information operations, on influence operations, on perception management, on disinformation, misinformation. So there are a lot of things maybe, that can be a basis for a dialogue between such Indian entities and the British entity.
You think politically, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that comes out of the UK which we don't like.
Right.
Whether it's the Labour Party or other groups.
Yes.
So... looking at how the elections are likely to go from what we read, if the Labour Party comes in and some of those old issues rise again, is that going to hit this also?
Oh, it will, definitely. But therefore, I think both sides are racing against time to try and clinch the free trade agreement. There is expectation that before the G20 summit, which is in September in India, where the British Prime Minister will be in India, that they need to either do it like what they did with Australia, do a part FTA to begin with, and then build up on that. Is also a possibility. And in any case, all this thing that we spoke about, the defense and technology sector, is only a subset of the FTA that India and British government are trying to put together or clinch the agreement on. And it should be looked at in that context rather than just standalone defense or technology cooperation, because that hasn't gone very far unless it is part of that larger all of government approach for free trade. Between both the governments, this will not work.
So, stepping away a little bit from the defense part of it, you spent a few days there, you know.
Yes.
How is India gauged? I mean, what is the sense about India? We need so much hype, you know. I mean,
definitely India is the flavor of the season, you might call it, or everybody is looking at India as a next destination in terms of finance. Financial sector, India as a market, a lot of these companies, they're traders basically. The British have been traders, shopkeepers and traders. So they are always looking at the opportunities that what can they do here. And Indian diaspora is very strong again in UK, and they are into various sectors. I found a lot of Indians working in the IT-enabled services. In banking, in finance sector, in their backbone of their technology, I mean the internet and the telecom sector, a lot of Indians working there as in their own firms, their consultancies, and also their employees, which shows that India has come a long way from being a destination, Britain being a destination only for education, really, because that continues. There is a lot of demand for King's College. There's a lot of demands for LAC, for instance, from the Indian diaspora, or from Indian students going there. But I think India has diversified, or Indian people have diversified their interest in UK by getting into businesses, getting into services, and also becoming a part of a larger part of the society. Heathrow seems to me like any other Indian airport, where you find brown faces and, being manned. The immigration counters being manned by them, the services being provided by them. So it's a different thing. I went there after three or four years, so it was a good to go and see what's happening there. Although inflation and the job market is not too good in UK at the moment.
See, I'm told India is one of the biggest investors in the City of London.
Right.
Are we able to leverage that diplomatically, or did you get that sense?
I didn't get that sense. No, we still haven't got there. I think unlike the US, where the Indian diaspora has got into being influential groups, lobby groups in terms of politics of the Democrats and the Republicans. Here, I think the Indian diaspora is limited to being politicians themselves, rather than lobby groups or influential groups. This is again a very, very preliminary impression that one gathers after talking to people and, reading something or meeting people. So I'm not sure whether I'm giving you the full picture. I may be wrong. But yes, there are attempts for Indians to get into positions where they can influence policies, influence politics. Indian origin people. I can't say they are Indians, but Indian origin people.
So last question, Mo. Like the defense relationship, which had a late start. Even military exercises, again, also had a fairly late,
Well, yes, there is, this is where exactly the point that one must try and understand how it has fallen off the radar. Britain and India, or the UK military and Indian military, had thought about a joint naval exercise way back in the early 90s or late 90s, mid-90s. But that hasn't happened as regularly as the exercise between Indian and French navies, for instance.
Or even the US.
There is that Konkan series of exercises. US, of course, is the largest number of exercises the Indian military does. with US military, various branches of US military, but exercise Konkan with UK hasn't been as frequent, hasn't been as regular as it should be. Whereas exercise Varuna with the French Navy has been an extremely successful and regular exercise, which shows up in various other ways when the defense cooperation goes in a different direction. When you work with each other, the interoperability comes in, you understand each other's techniques and ethos and practices, then it's a different ball game altogether.
And the British tendency to keep playing that
Pakistan. Yes, the Pakistan, and then also being, like some somebody said, that the British still think that only they can give to India and India must receive everything that they give. The supercilious attitude that is there, that must be shared, is what everybody thinks in India. I mean, at least those who deal with the UK. Hopefully that message keeps going to the UK.
Is it changing in that sense?
It is changing. They're, like I said, they want to woo India now. Obviously, you know, the establishment is very keen to do something. But again, these impediments keep coming in the way.
Interesting. Let's hope we have another round of this ISS Bharatshakti dialogue. And should be interesting.
Should be happening in India next year, but let us see.
Great.
Fingers crossed.
Looking forward. Thanks, Nitin. That's all we have for now. Do look forward to our, do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Follow us on social media and Twitter. Thank you very much. Good night.